Alright.
Levels elder with Turkish, not too much. I'm not sure about your level, but I know you know some words.
So
Last
I
year
know.
you mentioned something like
Yeah,
opening speech.
I know much. Like I know much less than I should, considering that my wife is from Istanbul. So actually, I should know more. Yes, can I increase the font size? Yes, definitely. So we can jump into, or let me go into presentation mode and let's see how good whoops. Presentation mode. And then I
You
go back
didn't
to this
watch
and
last year's presentation. I would recommend to check out our YouTube channel. And last year, Kevin made a presentation about test container. And this year, he will answer your question. He will make interactive session with you.
I think last
Okay,
year
we are
you
turn off.
did a presentation about blockchain even.
You done it two presentation, not one. So one is
Ah yeah,
about
one
test
workshop
container.
test container. Yeah, you're right. Yes, sure.
Yeah.
One workshop, one session. Yes, I am the I am in charge. I know everything. Okay. We are
Cool.
giving this sent to you, so you can start whenever you want. It's timed.
Okay, yes. Then
And Jack.
hello. Hello everyone. Yes, also again like Merhaba. So I'm mostly here now to discuss problems or questions you have with test containers, if you're using it already, if you're thinking about using it, if you have any questions, what are best practices, what are patterns to avoid, or how to get started if you want to contribute to test containers, the open source project yourself. And yep, so mostly the idea is that you come with the stuff you have. If there are some folks that don't even know what is test containers, okay, then I could dive a little bit and give an intro and show some things, or we can together look at how I how engage with developing stuff or fixing stuff for test containers, because kind of while preparing the session, I found more or less two bugs that are a little bit Windows specific that I want to investigate. So we can also dive in there and check how this works. Yes, but yeah, what you want to do? So the idea is that it's a more or less an ask me anything session. So yeah, ask me anything. And yeah, just ask by speaking or by writing. While you think about what you want to ask, I can my maybe we can a little bit check some things, some examples we have. So I checked out the test containers project for what we have from GitHub exactly. And can I increase the font size even more? Or someone already took care of this, yeah, because I think now it's quite increased. So if you check out test containers, which you normally would not do as a user, because as a user you would not develop on the library itself, but okay, I am also developing. If there is a question, you can show something. Okay, so far there are no questions. Please don't hesitate if you have any questions, whatever they are, like you say, okay, we already started using test containers in our company, but we have this kind of problem and we wonder if this approach is good, or we discover this is a problem, or we were thinking about using test containers and we have this one technology we want to integration test, like this kind of obscure database. Would this work? Then we can together look at it and maybe think. Or the best thing even is if you have your stuff somewhere at GitHub open source, yeah, then we can even build it in there. So I did a session some time ago for an open source project. We did it on Twitch and we just took an existing open source project that was using H2 databases for integration testing, and we replaced this with test containers to then get directly Postgres for integration testing. That was quite nice. So maybe to give you an idea what you can do with test containers, let's check some of the existing stuff we have here now. So what could be a nice example? Maybe some generic Docker JUnit test. So of course now these tests are now a little bit more involved to the library and not how you would use the library. Yeah. So since I want to show you first, because I don't know if there are people in the audience that never heard about test containers, I want to give you a rough idea about how as a user you would interact with it. So therefore I try to pick a library that makes sense for this. I think this is what I wanted to see. Yes, let's check these JUnit examples. These are good, I think. Yeah. Okay, so assume you don't know anything about test containers so far, and you just want to see, okay, how can you basically interact with it? There are different ways to interact with it, but in a nutshell, test containers is an object-oriented abstraction around or in front of Docker containers, so that you can have Java objects that represent your Docker containers and that you can interact with, and that give you certain convenience features for the lifecycle and for their ready state and so on, especially for tests. So the main idea is to use those containers for integration tests, but there can be different use cases actually. But you see, the library is a little bit opinionated towards integration tests, I would say. And now we have special JUnit or test framework integration. Here we see the JUnit 5 integration. But you can also use it without any kind of test integration. But let's look at this now. You see here some commented stuff. So just ignore those. We use those as markers to generate the official documentation, the markdown documentation from the source code. So in reality, you don't need to use them, but we have them in the examples because by this, we get the code snippets in the markdown out of it to generate our HTML documentation on the website. So we have here some tests that interact with a Redis key value store system database, however you would call it. And you can see you specify a generic container as a class, and you just specify which image you want to use. Okay, we now have this new API, by the way, since some versions, that you have to specify a Docker image name. So before, you could also use a string just for the Docker image name, but we tried to we deprecated this because it's not always a very nice stable API, and it's a little bit nicer to have to make sure this Docker image name goes in there, and then you can just pass it here in this with a static function. We define that we want to interact with it on this port. Okay, and then we just say, okay, before each, we get, after the container has started, some basically dynamic stuff from it, like the actual host it's running on and the port it has been mapped to, because this can be anything. This is dynamic and determined by Docker, and also the host on which the container is reachable is more or less dynamic, because you could have a Docker environment locally, or the Docker daemon could run somewhere else and whatever. Yeah, and then we have, this is our actual production class, and then we check that we can do some stuff here. So let me run it and see what happens, and then I will attend to the question. So now it's running here, and while this is running, I want to open the terminal. Okay, and let's just do watch docker ps. Whoopsie. Okay. And ideally, we should see some things happen. Maybe not. Run.
Kevin, by the way, there is a question. Can you briefly go into the lifecycle of our containers when using JUnit? I know we can specify things like per class etc, but how do these affect the containers? Selim asks.
Yeah, this is a very good question. So we will really look into this as part of this example. Even we can do it. So it's a good question. So I want to just see the run view here again. How can I do this with a shortcut? Someone knows. Just want to have this run view. Yeah. Ah, like this. Okay, test event were not received. Why? What did happen here? Okay, warning, what went wrong? No test found, forgiven includes. What? Why not? Okay, it's probably a Gradle thingy that we can't. Run it here. Let me just run it with. If we run it with in with JUnit, it should work instead of Gradle. Or maybe it does not. Let's check. Maybe the JUnit for example. Maybe this is easier. Generic JUnit for example. Ooh, many examples here. Okay. Let's maybe do the. Redis one to have something similar. And if I get this working from the IDE, then we can look in exactly into this topic of the question. Okay, this looks better. That's the Gradle thingy, yeah, which test runner is configured there. Okay, cool. So. Okay, now we saw it worked, and if we run it again, and then I switch quickly back to the terminal, and then we ideally see now, okay, we see the container pop up, so it spins up the Redis container, it runs the test, and then it's gone again. Okay. Run view. Okay. So now what is happening in this case? This is now using the JUnit 4 integration. Before we had the JUnit 5, but it's it works the same, especially with regards to this life cycle. If we define it as add rule, it means the container gets created and started and stopped on a per method basis. If we would do add class rule, then yeah. Then now we would use the same container for each method. So then it gets started and stopped lifecycle based on a class, on a test class basis. And you have a new instance then for every class. So in this case, it doesn't change anything because it's the same test. But if we would do a second test, yeah, just, and then we do bar, okay, and then we do here under test, and we say okay, get who, and then here say the bar, then this should work. Now we would change before to before all, I assume. Before class in JUnit 4, that's it. Okay, and now it should work, and we should see two things. No, this doesn't work because now this is not static. Static under test. Okay. Method must be static, of course. Static void. All right, now of course this also needs to be static. Yeah, okay. Okay. So now we saw okay, both tests run, and we see already like this is the first test, it takes a bit longer, 25 milliseconds. This is test is a bit faster, 5 milliseconds, because it can use reuse the same container. Now, what we did here with this class rule, we can very, very easily replicate manually. So let me just remove this class rule, oops, like this. So we still leave the field here. And now what I do, I here run Redis start. And then just to make it a little bit cleaner, we can do a teardown, public static void teardown. And after class, and then we do Redis stop. Although I don't have to do this because the container gets automatically stopped and cleaned up if all tests are finished. No, it's the JVM exits actually. So we can do this also like this. And this is interesting because it shows you this test framework integration is actually minimal. It does really not a lot. Just it hits these callbacks before class, before method to run this, to run these method, start and stop. And I think we can check, we can look into the implementation to see that this is actually happening. And we can do this in a bit. Yes. But first, let's look, what is the question from Christian? Yes, because it's easy to answer. So Christian is asking, his microservices are too heavy to run locally. Can test containers run externally on a server in some cloud? Yes, it can. So basically, it is transparent to where the Docker daemon is running. So assuming already in this case here where I'm now, so I'm on Docker for Windows, and my IntelliJ is running, and therefore test containers, the test containers process, so to say, it's running in Windows and it's talking with the Docker daemon that is running in WSL too, in the case of Docker for Windows. And you could also configure with something like Docker machine or with the Docker host variable or whatever, you can configure an Docker daemon that is running remotely somewhere, and then it will automatically and very transparently interact with it. Just you have to keep some things in mind because, and yeah, good point. This is the reason we use this here, Redis get host. Okay, that's why we don't say localhost, we say get host, because we don't know where the user will execute the test or the CI if it's set up differently than the local developer machines. And if you do it like this, it will automatically take the host of the according host of the Docker daemon in this case. So that's a good practice and a best practice for using test containers. Don't use localhost, here hard-coded localhost. In this case, I can probably just do it also. Yeah. So let's do like this, it will also work. Or we can even make a breakpoint and see what we get there. So let's just watch this. This is not available. What? Why is it not working? Oh, this is completely. Different test, how I ended up here. Huh. What was this test? It was a Spock test, okay, whatever. I wanted to debug this one, of course. And I wanted to make here the breakpoint. Okay, why I'm adding, okay. So what am I doing here? Why is IntelliJ jumping into another breakpoint in a completely different class? I'm not sure. Let's try again, last time. If not, it doesn't matter. Okay, I don't know what's up with IntelliJ here. Because the class has the same name, but it's in a different package. And now it put the breakpoint somewhere completely else. What? Okay. Whatever. Let me just run it again like this and not use this whatever happened here to the debugger. As you see, I put in localhost now and it works. Okay, all good. But the clean way is to take the get host and put it in there. All right, so we've seen this. Now we've seen this. And if I, so the test finished, and if I go back into the terminal, oops. OK, Okay, Docker PS, everything is empty. Now what happens if I remove this? Okay, I don't stop the container after the classes. We run the test. And again, the okay, let's remember this is Alt F12. Alt F12. Alt F12. It's not opening the terminal. Okay, whatever. So we see the containers are running. The tests are over, but now they are gone. Okay, why they are now gone? Although I removed the stopping. And that is because test containers spawns this additional Sidecar container called Ryuk, and it will automatically stop and remove and clean up all the test containers resources after the JVM exits, basically. So the JVM is constantly sending kind of a heartbeat to this Sidecar container, Ryuk container, and if it stops sending these heartbeats, it knows something happened, either the tests are finished or the JVM crashed or whatever, and then it will execute a cleanup routine, basically. And that's very convenient because on CI, this might sometimes happen. You can have an out-of-memory error or whatever. The JVM might crash, and therefore it can't clean up its external resources in this way. And we, by this, still have a process running outside in a container that can do this cleanup for us. That's very good, but also something to keep in mind, because that means if you're using, like if you want to, for example, check what happened with a container after a test, and you want to debug it, if the JVM is exited, the container will be gone. So then you can't do it. You have to have a breakpoint somewhere that keeps the JVM running, basically. Okay, and since now this is possible, we can even do different things. A pattern, we call it singleton container pattern. So this is normally done in a different way, but I try to replicate it here in this class file, and it's very useful, and it's also documented. So we do a static initializer block. Whoa. Okay, German keyword layout for a second. So we just do the static initializer block, and now what we do in this, we run the Redis dot start. Okay, then I can even remove it here. Okay, and normally you would put this in an abstract class somewhere, and then all the tests that would use this container would extend this abstract class. And what you do by this in a like maybe a little bit hackish or tricky way, but basically you now say, okay, I purposely want to bind the lifecycle of my container to the lifecycle of my JVM, because when the class gets loaded, the container gets started. And so if we run it like here now, nothing will change for us. And as you saw before, we don't necessarily need to stop the container, because in the end, when the JVM exits, Ryuk will automatically clean up the resources after all. And if we do it like this, we can basically share a container between a suite or a set of classes, so to say. Okay. So yeah, we can check again in the terminal. So okay, no container running anymore. And in many, many cases, this is one of the best patterns, because while it might be look convenient to instrument the life cycle of those containers on a per method basis, on a per class basis with those JUnit integration, it is actually quite expensive. So of course, containers are much cheaper than virtual machines. It's much cheaper to create and start and stop a Postgres container as compared to a virtual machine hosting a Postgres database. Yes, it's true, but it's still expensive. And this expenses that come at the cost of sometimes milliseconds, sometimes seconds, they sum up over the whole of your test suite. And at one point, you really end up again with quite slow test suite. And for example, the test container test suite itself, because it uses a lot of integration tests and it has to create many, many containers, it is in itself a quite heavy test suite that can take like 40 minutes to execute in a whole. And that's not what you want in general for your development productivity cycle in your normal projects. So really consider if you can use this pattern, single container pattern, which you can also find in the documentation, to speed up your whole test suite. And then you can say, okay, yeah, this might lead to test pollution because now I'm reusing the same database for all the tests. But then just think about how to clean up tests, how to avoid test pollution on a logical level instead of on the infrastructure level. Logical level meaning, okay, clean up the schema, roll back the transaction, whatever, like things we did before as well. So, other questions, topics we should dive into, or I also have maybe a simpler example we can look into before we try to dive into some of the more convoluted hands-on stuff. Or maybe you want to see just what test containers does to execute those lifecycle things. We can look at this and you will see it's pretty simple. And you will learn a little bit how test container as a project is structured. So this is the root of the project, and we have different modules, and those different modules are the specific container implementations, like something like an InfluxDB, something like a Kafka, whatever. They're in those modules, but the core and the JUnit 4 stuff is actually also part of the core, is in this core module in the root. So in the sources here we have the core, and now we dive into some of the like really core classes of test containers that are also a little bit historic, or you can say legacy and so on. So you will see to a certain degree those JUnit core integration is part of the generic container class, which is one of the main classes. So we have this container interface that defines the interface, and it will have methods like start, or has it like we have a better one. It's like let me check it's lifecycle aware. Where are we have lifecycle test lifecycle aware, exactly. So this is very nice. This allows you to let's check the implementations. This is just a browser web driver container, so it's a bit more involved. Let's not go into this. Let's maybe just check how the JUnit 5 container does it, or the JUnit 5 extension does it, because it's a bit more simple. And if you don't ask me a simpler question, I will just dive deep, okay, and assume you understand what I'm doing, else stop me. So let's look at how the JUnit 5 module is implemented, JUnit Jupyter, because there you see a little bit better from the outside how this integration in a test framework works. All right, so this is in its super slim implementation. So this is a test containers extension. This is a JUnit 5 Jupyter extension. And you see it implements some of those callback interfaces. Oh yes, I will go to this question in a bit. So what we see now, basically we let's do the before each. It's easier to find. So this callback is executed by JUnit before each test method, basically. And here what we do, we these are from the parent, but basically what we do, we collect all fields, all annotated fields in the test class that are annotated with container, and then we call the signal before test to container. Okay, what does it do? It says to each container before test. Okay, that's actually it. Let me check where is the starting happening. It's here. Okay, yes, yeah, this is what we do. So before each container, like before each test, we call start on the container, basically. And then after each, we should see, we call a stop, ideally. Even differently, yeah. So in JUnit 5, we could implement this differently because we can implement it as a closable resource. Then JUnit automatically calls container stop on it. Okay, so you see, it's a super okay, a little bit involved the class because it, with more or less reflection or whatever, it has to get the fields out of the class. But in a nutshell, all it does is calling start on the container to start them up. Okay, from Christian, we had a question. How do you handle dependency between containers, like app container waiting for DB to be ready? Yes, this is a good example or a good question. And I hope, yes, we even have a test for this. So I can show you how we do it. So what you do, this is a bit mocky. This is, involves a lot of mocks. So let me just jump back into our Redis container, our Redis example. Okay, and now let's assume we have another container here, Rx static generic container. And just for the sake of it, it's also a Redis, but let's say this is the application. Yeah, but I'm just using the same here to not pull another image or whatever. And now what we can say, okay, our application depends on Redis. Okay, and now what I can do, I can say, stream off. So we say stream off Redis and application, then we say parallel, and then we say for each, then we do generic container start. Oopsie. Okay, so we can also do it like this. And in this case, they wait for each other, basically. And it's even parallelized as good as possible. And so as compared to other, or as compared to using Docker directly, if there you can also in Docker Compose, you can specify depends on, for example. And let's just run it and see what happens. So in Docker Compose, you can say depends on. And what this will lead to in Docker Compose, that it waits in the start process on the other container. Okay, so you see here is it's creating now two containers, yeah, and starting them both. Maybe let's change here the image, and then we maybe see the order. And I'm also just trying this out. Yeah, I haven't tried this stuff out before. I assume it should work like this. Now it takes a little bit because it will pull the image. So as opposed to Docker Compose, where the depends on will specify the order of creating and starting the container, in case of test containers, it also means waiting until the application in the container is ready. Okay, so that's a difference there. So let's check here. Okay, so we see first 5.3 is started and then 5.0. Okay, and we said first Redis application. Let's turn this around. Let's see if it works also like this. So as you see, I turned this around again, 5.3 was executed first. So this dependency formulation works. And now, again, as opposed to Docker Compose, with test containers, it really waits until the application is ready inside the container. And how does it do it? That works because test containers provides a number of weight strategies. And these tell test containers if the application is ready. You can find them in weight, yeah? So in those strategies. These are the weight strategies there are. As a default, Docker will use this host port weight strategy. This will just mean, okay, check that those ports that get published externally are available, like you can connect to them. So we can check at the implementation here. Okay, so what we do, get when ready, internal call, check. Ah, okay, this is using this internal strategy. Mm-hmm. Internal or external command, okay. And yeah, it's a little bit more involved, but in a nutshell, you can see this is what's happening here, yeah? So it opens the socket and tries to open the socket and connect to this port. And then it knows, okay, container is reachable. So, and we have different strategies. Log message weight strategy, sometimes very useful. For example, in the Postgres container implementation, we just use this log message weight strategy. In the log message one, it just, this wait until ready, it just checks that a certain configured regex is hit. Yeah. So this wait predicate until this is fulfilled. And by using these, so Docker health check is super trivial. It just checks that the is healthy, that the container becomes healthy. So if you have implemented a Docker health check in your image, then you can use this super, super easily. Or those HTTP weight strategies you can also use. And yeah, don't be now afraid, because we look into the implementation all the time. As a user, it's of course simple to use. You just specify, we can look at it. So we could say, okay, then we would say, and it doesn't make sense in this context, but we just do it. We say waiting for, and we say wait for HTTP, and then it would here FUBAR. Okay, in this case, it would wait that this HTTP endpoint responds with 200. This works very well with something like Spring Boot microservices and something like Actuator, for example. Yeah. Okay, yes. Are there other questions? Any other questions? Something more that we should go back maybe one step, something more simple we should look into? So else I have some to-dos, but they might be quite complicated to fix, but we can look into them to see how I get on debugging stuff in test containers itself. So if no one has any other questions, we might just start looking into them and see if we can quickly fix them. But I'm not sure. Maybe they are super hard to fix. I haven't discovered them too much yet. So because this is something I'm quite curious about, what is happening here. So we can maybe look into this. And if you have any questions, I will jump there. So nowadays, I don't know where you are running on Docker for Windows, Docker for Mac, Linux, or whatever. I, for some time now, switched to Docker for Windows with WSL2 on Windows. Before, I was always using Linux for development, also for using test containers and developing test containers, and was in general quite smooth because, okay, Linux is a super native way to run Docker containers. And Windows, it's of course very different. On Mac, it's also different. On Mac and on Windows, the containers are running in a virtual machine. And Yeah, Mac has always been kind of a first-class citizen for test containers, mainly because many developers using Mac and Docker for Mac, and also because the other two maintainers, Richard North and Sergey Egorov, they both use Macs to develop test containers. And I was using always Linux, so for a long time there was no perfect Windows support. Also, Docker support on Windows was quite struggling for a long time. Then Docker for Windows came. So first we had Docker Toolbox with those weird VirtualBox stuff that was many years ago. Then we got Docker for Windows that was using those Hyper-V virtual machine, but everything felt still like a little bit Windowsy. Now, since, I don't know, last year, I think, was it summer last year or maybe even longer, we have WSL2, Windows subsystem for Linux 2. And I think this changed, or it's kind of a game changer for Windows development, in my opinion, but it's kind of glitchy in certain points. Yeah, so it tries to work as a Docker would work everywhere, but in practice, of course, it can't, because there are certain idiosyncrasies on Windows that are kind of Windows specific. The file system that you have, like named pipes instead of a Unix socket and so on, to communicate with a daemon. So it jumps through some hoops. And if we look at the, let's look in the terminal. So now I'm running on Windows right now, but this terminal now is in WSL2. So Docker version, okay, yeah, I have here some Docker version, and this WSL2 is inside Ubuntu, so the Ubuntu distribution. But actually, the Docker engine is not running inside this, or not really running inside this WSL2 environment. It's running in its own kind of virtual machine, and then they do some magic to kind of map it to make it look like it's running there locally. It's really crazy. I don't know. Do we get additional infos here? So what it says, so it syncs everything. Okay, Docker root here is varlib Docker, and it should also say that it's communicating with the, where would you see it? That it would use the Docker socket. Does anyone know? The Docker context class. Show. Here, this I wanted to see. Okay, yeah, so it makes it look like it's running natively locally because it has a socket there and everything, but it's running a different VM. So it's very complex setup, but most things work. And some things right now are not working that I found in the morning, that the Docker Compose tests are not running correctly here on Windows. So we should investigate them. Let's just investigate them together. So Docker Compose, I know specifically that the override tests are not working, I think, or maybe more are not working. Let's check. Let's run the Docker Compose file test first. And probably some pass. Okay, this works nicely. Okay, that's interesting. Okay, so let's do Docker Compose container with service test. Do they work? Okay, that looks also quite good so far. Yeah, they will probably all work. So then I think the main culprit right now is this Docker Compose override test. So I know they fail. So we will check what happens if I run them. And what does test do? I'm not even sure. It could be this could be related to maybe something like this file path Windows thingy. Not sure, just a gut feeling. Okay, let's check the test. So the test is supposed to check that a override compose file works and it can probably override certain environment variables. So we see this is a JUnit 4 parameterized test. Yeah, already they start failing. A different base environment variable, right environment variable. Okay. Interesting. So let's check why is this test failing. Okay, the startup failed, really. So the startup is failing. With local compose local mode. Okay. If local mode, so it might be. Okay, so there are two ways to run Docker Compose from test containers. You can either run it in local mode or by also using a proxy container, so to say. Then it would run Docker Compose in a container. And maybe a certain class is not working. What was it? Alt2, no, Alt4, yep. So all are not. All are not working actually. Okay, so it that's interesting. So it doesn't matter if we are using local compose or not. Seemingly, it's not working. And the container startup fails. Okay. So, something seems to be wrong with this image, or is this compose file? I assume no. This would be in source test result. Maybe related that it specifies it completely like this. Could this be related? Not sure. It should normally use this, yeah? Okay. Again, if you have any questions and maybe something simpler you want to ask, I'm happy to go into there, but else I will go in. Going on debugging test containers bugs now. Yeah. So those are interesting. They should not be here. It could be related or not sure. So, where this came from. Docker compose test. This should also not really be there. So we should check maybe how the other specified. More or less the same. More or less the same. So if this test works, then the abstraction of accessing the file works. There's just something that makes could have to do with building, that it has to build, yeah, compose Docker file. Okay. Oh God. I have an idea. So, what encoding is this shell file? Shouldn't I normally see it here? Encoding, file encoding. Okay. Not the encoding, actually. I mean line ending, yeah? So if this is CLRF now, then we're kind of fucked. Yeah. And that could be the whole reason. Line ending. Line ending. Line. Is this line separators? So isn't there normally, I think if I make it bigger, there is a view that tells me like what are the line separators. But something changed now that I changed it. I think that's it. I think that's it, guys. I think that's it. Okay, let's try this again. Now the thing is it has to rebuild the image, which it hopefully does. Yeah. Looks not bad. Looks totally not bad. Yes, yes, yes. All right. Yes. Okay, cool. We fixed it. So I can actually say, yes, we can make a pull request because what we, how, so I didn't really fix it. Yeah, but we know how to fix it because this is just a Git attribute thingy. So now why did not this not trigger? I don't know. Yeah. Now, these are the things you still have to live with on Windows, yeah? You're building those Linux containers and they want Linux files with Linux encodings and Linux, yeah, whatever. But the Git client thinks like, oh, you're on Windows, let's do you something good, let's change the line break. So I don't know, I honestly don't know why this Git attribute was not applied. So someone, maybe someone with more Git experience can tell me why this didn't work. To do with the editor config, end of line also says LF. Yeah. But doesn't matter. This was definitely the problem. And I don't know, maybe there are one, two other cases, if there are other failures, that will have the same issue. Very interesting. Very interesting. Or do we have to do something like this? Maybe. I shall investigate this. Wonderful. So I don't know. I don't know if this was helpful or interesting for you, but yeah, that's sometimes what you have to deal with when you're supporting multiple platforms and Windows is getting better, but you still have these super Windowsy things that sometimes can creep up. For me, this was great because now I think I can, with very limited work, get a completely working Windows build for WSL2 back running. So that's nice for the library. And yeah, for all the users, it's nice to know that WSL2 works in general. But this can happen to you as well. Yeah, if you are, this is really a classic thing, like you're building a Docker image from your Windows file system and for whatever reason you now have a CLRF line break there, and then you're wondering like, oh, why suddenly the container doesn't start, what happened there, and then you just get this stupid error messages from Bash, like discovered end of file or whatever. Like you get these super weird error messages that are mega obscure. Yeah, so always make sure that the Bash scripts that end up in the Docker images really have a LF line ending. Yeah. Okay, come on, folks. One more question maybe before we wrap up the session. Anything? Or maybe you all already in the weekend. I think it's the last session for today. Do I see how many participants we have? 31. Okay, 31. So not all are gone. Yeah, or maybe even some of my students are here. I don't know. I heard they wanted to attend. Yep. I just answered some things people normally ask. So people always like to ask, does it work with Podman?
Yes, we have one question. Gavin.
Yes.
We just forwarded to chat screen.
Yes. Okay, from Selim, JUnit. Yeah, use JUnit platform for this module. Yes. In general, you're right. Now I wonder why. Probably because it's wrapped in the same module. Let me check. So basically, what Selim says, if you want to make JUnit tests run properly, you need to tell Grail to use JUnit platform for this module. That's correct. So we were in the docs, in the examples submodule. And so we don't have why is it not here then? That's a good point. So what is it? Is it just use JUnit platform or what? Or is it like test platform and then use JUnit platform? Do you know? Wait, it should be in the JUnit 5 module. Let me check that. Here. Okay, so maybe we found another bug. I think this part of the examples was probably never tested. Excellent. Okay, so now we edit this and now let's check. Maybe you have to go. Super session. We will have two pull requests coming out of this basically. Yeah, so I don't know. Very good. Thank you a lot, Selim. Yes, so this is not a super important piece of the library or whatever. These are just the examples that I use to generate the code examples for the documentation. But still, the idea is always that we actually execute the test so that we can ensure that the tests we show in the documentation really work. I think this is a very nice pattern. And for example, Groovy does it like this as well. For the documentation and a beautiful question from Maruna. Have you played with Spock and test containers? Yes, I have, because I am the author of the Spock extension for test containers. That's how I came to test containers. I contributed the Spock extension. So and then because the Spock extension is so super, super easy that after I implemented it, I just joined the main team because there was nothing to do for the Spock extension anymore. So you also have the documentation about it. We have the example here. It looks then like this for Spock. Yeah, so even simpler. And it's very similar to the JUnit extension, JUnit 5 extension. You annotate a class with add test containers, and then all container fields in this class will get automatically instrumented. Yep, and that's the idea of it. So if you need it or not, it depends, because as I said before, sometimes it's better to manually control the container lifecycle, for example, to do those singleton container tests. And so we can look at the SPOC implementation of the SPOC extension, which was done in Groovy, interestingly. Yeah. Good old Groovy. So this is the test containers extension. This uses this spec annotation. So then if the test container annotation is in it, which is a element type, element method, but I don't know, it should not be on the method, I assume. This is, I think, historic, whatever. We have this annotation. If it's there, it adds this setup spec, cleanup spec, interceptors, basically. And then we have this method interceptor, and then it finds all containers in the class, and then it starts the containers, it finds compose containers, it starts those containers. So it's super, super simple. And finding containers is just using reflection to find the containers. Okay, and another question from Mahuna, what I think about Microshed. So Microshed, if I remember correctly, from the Open Liberty guys or something, and it started out as a test containers sub-module or whatever, and we just told them, okay, maybe better to spin to put it out as a real project, because the test containers part is quite small and it's more concerned with this also this kind of client generation thingy for the JEE web controller or whatever. So I haven't used it myself really, because I haven't done a lot of JEE development in some time now, but I think it is probably right now one of the best ways to use test containers in a JEE context, you know, or Jakarta context, yes, let's say like this. And yes, it uses heavily test containers. All right. Okay, if there's anything else, or else we are over to the end of the session now also. And I'm happy there were some more questions coming. And I'm happy we found some bugs to fix or pull requests to write and submit now. That's good.
Thank you very much, Kevin, for your contribution.
All right.
Yeah. Thank you, Christian, Selim, and Muran for and enlightening this session with their questions. And thank you, Kevin, for a very good session and showing us the details. And finally, I'm glad that it worked.
Yes.
Okay. Do you have any words? We are closing. This is the last session of the event conference.
Oh, yes, my wife should have written me a nice sentence. I should have said now in Turkish. Sadly, she didn't do. Well, bad preparedness, Lihan. Okay. So no, then thank you for having me virtually, and I'm just looking forward to maybe next year or whenever visit in real life and visit Istanbul and see all of you, and yes, have a good time then as well, and I wish everyone a nice weekend. I can't say yes, güle güle.
Yeah, thank you
very much.
Teşekkür ederim. Teşekkür ederiz.
Teşekkür ederiz. Seneye görüşmek üzere.
Thank you. Hope to see you next year. Bye bye.
Bye.